Greetings, everyone. This is Katherine Franke from Columbia Law School, and it's wonderful to have you join us today for our webinar and CLE on Is It a Felony to Provide Water to Migrants? This program is sponsored by the Law, Rights, and Religion Project at Columbia Law School, and we just have these incredible advocates with us today to talk about this kind of work where religious liberty is being used in cases where activists, particularly in the Southwest, are showing up for migrants who are coming through the southern Arizona desert and who would die and are dying without water and food. And the United States government is prosecuting them, in some cases for felonies, for providing water and food, for saving the lives of other human beings. So today's CLE is going to cover some of the background of the law that applies in these contexts, some of the advocacy strategies that we've been using in these contexts as criminal defense lawyers, both now and in the 1980s, when other sanctuary activists were also prosecuted by the federal government for providing safety and care to migrants fleeing violence in Central America and coming to the United States. And then we're also going to spend a little bit of time on the ethics of the ethical considerations and tensions that arise in these cases. And we couldn't have a better panel to do that, cover those topics with us. But first, I need to do a little housekeeping. Because this is a CLE and it's qualified for you to get CLE credit in New York State for this webinar, if you're participating, if you are a participating New York attorney and you would like to receive CLE credit, please note that you're required to complete two things. The attendance affirmation form that was emailed to you and is also attached as a handout on the software associated with the webinar, and also the evaluation form. And when you fill in the attendance affirmation form, you'll have to put in two verification codes. I'm going to be announcing those codes at 12:45 and at 1:40. So if you want credit for the entire program, all of the credits that we have available for this program, you'll have to enter both of those codes. And then the forms are also available to download from other sources that we'll clarify later. So let me first introduce our amazing panelists. First is Alan Yaroshefsky, who is an Associate Dean for Research and Faculty Development, as well as the Howard Lichtenstein Distinguished Professor of Legal Ethics. And if that's not enough, she's also the Executive Director of the Monroe H. Freedman Institute for the Study of Legal Ethics at Hofstra Law School. Professor Yaroshefsky teaches a range of courses having to do with ethics and social movements, and organizes symposia and writes, and is an extremely well-respected scholar and practitioner of legal ethics and criminal law. I first met Ellen years ago when she was a staff attorney at the Center for Constitutional Rights, and has been very active as part of the criminal defense team in the 1980s for activists in southern Arizona who were prosecuted for providing aid, comfort, and sanctuary to migrants from Central America. So that expertise is hugely important in our talking about the issues today. Grey Kuykendall is also with us. He was and is the attorney, the criminal defense attorney for Scott Warren, who is a volunteer with the group No More Deaths, No Más Muertes, that is based in southern Arizona and has been coordinating the recovery efforts for bodies found in the desert, but also aid for those who are crossing in terms of water and food, clothing in the winter when it's cold. But Greg has provided criminal defense representation to Scott Warren, who's been prosecuted for felonies and misdemeanors in connection with his work with No More Deaths. He is a partner with Kuykendall & Associates. They're based in Tucson, Arizona. He is a board certified criminal law specialist since 2000 and is approved as counsel for the International Criminal Court and lead counsel for the Special Tribunal for Lebanon. His breadth of experience, his political commitments and roots are broad, as you can tell from the longer biography that's included in the materials for today. So I want to thank Ellen and Greg for joining us from Tucson, and Ellen somewhere in New York. We're all separated from each other at this point because of the pandemic that we're experiencing, but it's good to be together virtually today. So what I'd like to do first is start out with a bit of an overview of religious liberty law and the history of religious liberty claims brought by advocates who have shown up for the rights of migrants, whether it's in Tucson, whether it's in other parts of the country today and in the 1980s. And Ellen, I'd like to have you get us started with the work that you did for migrants activists in the 80s, and then we'll bring it forward to where the law is today. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Katherine. Thank you for putting this together. I'm delighted to be part of it, and I applaud all the work that you are doing, both as the president of the Center for Constitutional Rights, but particularly at Columbia and putting together these very important programs. So let me do a little background. In the 1980s, the Reagan administration was supporting very repressive governments in El Salvador and in Guatemala. Archbishop Romero, the archbishop in El Salvador, had been murdered. Thousands of people began to flee El Salvador and Guatemala. They were victims of political persecution. They belonged to social groups where they would be persecuted, and they had well-founded fears of persecution. The ones that came to the U.S. were systematically denied asylum. And it was because our government was supporting those repressive regimes. And so over time, what happened was sanctuaries developed through the faith-based movement. Churches in Arizona, in Chicago, in Texas, throughout the United States, developed a network with people in Mexico and Salvador and Guatemala to help people escape and to make sure that they got to safety. The sanctuary churches around the country were part of this network. And as the movement grew, and it grew in the early 80s, the leaders of this movement, including the Reverend John Fife of the Southside Presbyterian Church, who I believe is on this webinar today, appeared on the cover of Time magazine, in print, in television media. This was all pre-internet. They were obviously tempting the United States government to go after them because they kept growing. More people were assisting refugees. The leaders consistently were exposing the failure of what was then named the Immigration and Naturalization Service, the INS, their failure to grant asylum to people, to deserving refugees, because of our government's political commitment. They explained the policies of the government, they exposed the failure to the courts to grant asylum, and they explained how the religious communities had actually filed for asylum for so many people they lost, and they appealed to the Ninth Circuit and they lost. So there was systematic denial, and the public was beginning to understand this. So it was only a matter of time, of course, before the United States government decided we are going to prosecute the leaders of this movement to try to stop it. The first prosecution was in Texas of a young woman named Stacy Merkt, and that followed by the indictment of 12 priests, nuns, ministers, and sanctuary workers in Arizona. That's the case that I was involved in. And they were indicted on 70-something counts for bringing in, transporting, harboring, and concealing aliens, is the term in the statute. That's what it's called. They're called aliens. A priest and a religious worker in Mexico were also indicted, and they were to face charges along with 10 of the other sanctuary workers. And the government, of course, never expected them to show up. They lived in Mexico, but was remarkable that they each decided every day to come to court. They would come from Mexico to Arizona to stand trial with everyone else. The case that went on for some 7 months was based almost entirely upon the information gathered by a man who was artfully named Jesus Cruz. He was a government informant. He had pretended to work with the Southside Presbyterian Church for nearly a year in the sanctuary mission, and he gathered months of evidence against many of the sanctuary workers. The defense, and there were 12 of us that gathered to prepare this, 12 lawyers, 12 defendants. The defense mounted significant support from religious leaders around the country. in support particularly of a motion to preclude all the evidence that was obtained by Jesus Cruz because of his infiltration of the church. This has seemed unprecedented to many people that the government would send an informant into a church. The court, of course, denied the infiltration motion, but that issue exposed many individuals and groups to the power of the government to prosecute people. It was quite shocking for them to send an informant into a church. In this time period, the case was prominently featured in the popular press and significantly within faith communities around the country. I would say many of those faith communities had faith in the legal system and the power of the jury, their peers, to recognize the necessity to provide sanctuary for people fleeing prosecution. Unfortunately, this was not to be, and many lost faith in the system, if you will, legal system, by the end of the trial, because the expectations that people could tell their story in court were not met. Most of the defendants were politically and legally savvy. They understood the power of the courts to deny them the ability to present their evidence, and this is precisely what happened. So I want to just explain some of the basic theories. First of all, the judge didn't permit the defendants to present the defense of necessity. People think of this as a doctrine of the lesser of two evils, and it refers to the fact that if you engage in a lesser evil, that is, the conduct that you engage in is worse than the conduct that you're trying to prevent, which is the death of people returning to another country, and you've gone through all the legal remedies, and you had no choice but to take this action, you should be able to present that defense. That defense in law has very limited usage. It has been cut back over time, but we believe that if ever there was a case for the necessity defense, this was it, because certainly all the sanctuary workers had used the legal system. They had appealed for asylum. That was denied. They then appealed, and then they took an appeal from that. That was denied. And so it seemed that this would be perfect. But of course, the court ruled we could not use the necessity defense. Why? Because they hadn't filed a petition for certiorari, discretionary review, with the Supreme Court. It was pretty stunning as a claim by the court. So we couldn't do that. Religion, certainly people had sincerely held religious beliefs that they needed to engage in this form of action. And our argument was certainly, well, they had the intent to uphold the First Amendment. They didn't have the intent to violate the law, if you will. And of course, the court wouldn't allow that defense either. Our third and what we hoped would be the defense that we could use was that the intent of the sanctuary workers was to uphold the 1980 Refugee Act. We had been through 8 months of pretrial motions. We expected even after the 8 months of pretrial motions, we would be able to present that defense. And on the morning of the trial, the judge, Earl Carroll, ruled out that defense totally. He didn't even let us know in advance that we couldn't use it. Our anticipated defense was that even if the sanctuary workers were mistaken in their belief that they were assisting people who were qualified as refugees, they didn't intend to violate the law. So the court wouldn't let us do that either. The court also ruled, it was pretty remarkable, we weren't allowed to use certain words. We couldn't use the word refugee. We couldn't use the word torture. We could not talk about conditions in Central America because the court had ruled that out as relevant to the trial, and so on and so forth. The government kept using the word aliens in their summation. They even had little black stick figures that were aliens, and then they had the government in blue as the good guys. It was all an environment in which it was set up to actually convict people. The courtroom was packed every day. People who attended the seven-month trial knew the chances of acquittal were slim under the court's rulings. But the court's rulings and the trial itself became an opportunity for organizing around the country. Although it was true that most communities of faith, I believe, were not quite prepared for this exercise of state power. Or federal power, I should say. After 7 months of trial, the jury convicted 10 of the 12 defendants. on many of the 70 counts in the indictment. A count means each instance of assisting a refugee. Giving them transportation is one. Giving them food is another. We appealed, of course. We lost on appeal. The Ninth Circuit dealt with the religion argument out of hand, just basically saying religious exercise is not a defense to this violation of the law. I will say that what we're fortunate about is no one went to jail. We're very pleased about that. The sentencing day was one in which we were actually quite relieved because people had been prepared to go to jail. And even though we lost an appeal, there's much to say, and I'm curious as to our conclusions at the end of listening to what's going on today. But at that time, at least, I think the prosecutions were relatively effective in preventing sanctuary from blossoming further around the country. And I think in great measure because the sanctuary movement was not actually preparing sanctuary workers for the potential consequences of the way the law operates. And so I think it is a prime example in a political trial, the way in which the system actually does not permit people to be able to tell their story effectively.
Ellen, can I follow up with you just a little bit to draw you out a little bit more about the three defenses that you talked about? There was necessity. The
Correct.
Second was the idea that the activists were upholding the Refugee Act, which sometimes we describe as a civil initiative
Correct.
Defense, that because the government is not enforcing the laws, that government is acting illegally and
Right.
immorally, but technically illegally, civilians are enforcing the law through their actions. And then thirdly, the religious liberty claim, that
Right.
they were exercising protected rights under the First Amendment's free exercise of religious liberty protections. I wondered if you could just differentiate those three defenses out a little bit more for us.
Well, the necessity one, as I said, is the choice of evils. It's kind of similar to the civilian initiative defense in that you are saying that that the only option you have to prevent death is by engaging in this kind of action to, quote, violate the statute, right? And that because you've exhausted all other remedies under the law, that should be a defense that's recognized, okay? The civil initiative, I mean, it's interesting because in the 80s, that was a notion in international law primarily. I believe that we had raised it and that was also dismissed out of hand, but it is also a sense in which the court would say, you are engaging in a mistake of law, that you can actually trump our law, if you will, by using your own law. That civil initiative is not a defense to a criminal case. A mistake of fact, if you made a mistake about a fact, that could be a defense, but not the mistake of law. Is that helpful to explain the distinction there?
It is helpful because later in our discussion, as we get closer to the end of the session today, I'm going to want us to talk about the tensions between the activists who are working in these spaces in the 1980s, but also now, some of whom are motivated by secular morality, that this is just immoral and illegal what the government's doing, and some by faith-based sense of the sanctity of human life and the idea of welcoming the stranger, particularly when that stranger is in such dire circumstances. And as we have complex movements, we have people coming to sanctuary and immigrant defense for lots of different reasons, being able to lift up and protect only those who are able to plausibly articulate a religious motivation, a religious context for why they're acting, particularly in Warren's case, and Greg, I'm going to try to draw you out about this later, can create tension in our movements of why do the faith-based actors in our left and progressive movements get kind of the privilege of legal protections because of their religious beliefs, and the secular actors who feel no less moved to act do not and may risk going to jail more than those who are operating out of a faith-based motivation. And I wonder, Ellen, if there was any of that tension
that you felt or heard among the activists you were working with in the 80s?
Well, certainly not in our trial in Arizona. There was that sort of a tension between the groups that came from the North, with Chicago, Minnesota, were more, quote, politically based, some of whom were more secular. And there was a sense that they too should be able to engage in this kind of action to protect people. We did discuss in larger communities, and like for instance, the National Lawyers Guild had a Central America task force where that issue arose frequently. But the problem is that there's no First Amendment right for secular beliefs. There is a First Amendment religious belief right. And so it is a rubric under which people who actually had faith-based concerns could operate a bit more effectively, shall we say, in terms of using that law. Didn't work, but you know, much like today, the tension exists, but at least there is a vehicle. Now you have RFRA as well, which gives even more protection to people who operate out of religious beliefs than secular ones. That's why I think your question about the civil initiative is extremely important. It does operate in international law. We raised those kinds of issues. They were dismissed out of hand in the 80s. They were certainly dismissed out of hand. It was way before there was a development of significant international law on these issues.
Exactly. So what we thought we would do next, and I'll come back to both Ellen and Greg to draw out some of these questions, is that I could play law professor for a moment and just give us a little background on what the different protections are for religious liberty under the Constitution in the 80s, under the Constitution today, and under the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, which was passed by Congress in 1990, so that we have that kind of framework before we go to Greg and hear more about or hear about what the work is that's being done today with No More Deaths activists and how the religious liberty claims have been marshaled there. So for one moment, I'm going to share my screen, which, Lily, I believe you can allow me to do. So hold on one second. Our wonderful Lilia Hajivanova is administering us in the background. And thank you, Lilia, for all the work that you've done to get this webinar and others going. So Lily, are you able to get it to the point where I can share my screen? If not, then I will just go ahead and talk about this issue. So,
Katherine, if you want, I think I can change presenter and maybe you can pick up there.
Okay, go right ahead. If you make me the presenter, that'd be great. We're all getting used to this technology. for better or for worse. There we go. So. Can you all see it?
No.
All right. Thank you all who are listening and watching for your patience. Is that showing or no?
No.
Yeah? All right. So I want to talk about current protections for religious liberty and particularly as they contrast with the religious liberty rights that were available for Ellen, her legal team and their clients in the 1980s.
They're up now. It's working now.
Is it or no?
Yes.
It is.
Okay, great. So the current constitutional standard for religious liberty claims that are made under the First Amendment's Free Exercise Clause, so this is very in the First Amendment to the Constitution, Congress shall make no law with respect to either establishing a religion or of abridging the free exercise of religion. Right now, the protections for religious liberty are very low under the Constitution. Because of a decision by the Supreme Court in 1990, Employment Division versus Smith, where the court changed the constitutional protections and really lowered them. So during the period in which Ellen was litigating, the constitutional standard was a little bit higher than it was today. And that standard in the 1980s was more like strict scrutiny for the lawyers out there, that the if there was a law like the federal immigration laws that were being enforced, the harboring and other statutes that were being enforced, that was general in its applicability, meaning that it didn't single out people of faith, it applied to everybody equally who might be susceptible to violating that law, the government had to have a very good reason to justify the enforcement of that law if it burdened, imposed a substantial burden on the free exercise of religion. In 1990, Justice Scalia, who we all know was a devout Catholic, a man of faith himself, and certainly a political and legal conservative, wrote for the Supreme Court in Employment Division versus Smith that they were going to actually lower the constitutional standard for religious liberty to what we call rational basis review, meaning that if the law was generally applicable, it applied to everybody the same way, it didn't single out people because of their faith or their religious practices, it didn't really matter whether it imposed a burden on a person's religious practice, if the government could come up with any reason to justify having that law. And in, you know, in a case like these immigration and sanctuary cases, if there was some legitimate reason that the government had for enforcing immigration or the rules at the border, that was enough. So there really, since 1990 as a constitutional matter, have been very low protections for religious liberty, relatively low protections for religious liberty under the Constitution. And this, right after Employment Division versus Smith, from the right wing to the left wing, there was a sense of this is wrong. We need to have stronger protections for religious liberty in our federal law. And the idea then was that it was going to be a threat to religious minority groups, to the Amish, to Seventh-day Adventists, to Jews, to Muslims, to people who had faith-based practices that often were contrary to generally applicable law, like what day is your Sabbath, what kind of food do you eat as part of or can you not eat as part of your religious practices. And those people's practices would be substantially burdened by, let's say, a prison system that provided the same ham sandwiches to everybody to eat in the prison. Well, the Jews and the Muslims, their religious practices would be really substantially burdened by having to eat food that was deeply contrary to their systems of beliefs. And so the Congress passed the Religious Freedom Restoration Act in 1993 that basically put into federal law the same protections that we had had for religious liberty before Employment Division versus Smith, but as a federal statutory matter, not as a federal constitutional matter, because of course Congress can't on its own amend the Constitution. And again, it was interesting that it was both the right and the left that came together to see this as something that was critically important to do. And as an odd and interesting footnote, it was the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops who objected to RFRA, the language that was contained in the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, and they're the ones that held up the passage of RFRA for 3 years. Because they feared that abortion rights activists and other activists supporting reproductive justice would use religious liberty as a justification for access to abortion. And today this sounds so, you know, counterintuitive because it's the Catholic Church, the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, and other Christian evangelical right-wing actors who have been the primary users of religious liberty in order to undermine reproductive rights. But in the 1990s and in the late 1980s, there was very much of a sentiment that one could plausibly muster a faith-based justification for access to reproductive rights, to abortion, to contraception, in the idea that I should be the steward of my own family, my reproductive body, as a matter of faith. And so we've lost that sort of sense today. But it's just an interesting footnote to why it took 3 years for RFRA to pass. was because the Catholic bishops objected to it. So what does RFRA contain? It contains a general and very strong prohibition against, sorry everyone, the government action, policies, laws, whether they're formal or informal policy or laws, if those actions substantially burden a person's exercise of religion, even if the law or policy is one of general applicability, the person would get an exemption from compliance with that law in order to protect their religious practices, their faith-based practices. So it reinstalls the level of higher level of protections that had previously been in the Constitution. But there are exceptions, just as there had been in the constitutional standard. If that substantial burden on your exercise of religion imposed by the government can be in furtherance of a compelling government interest and is the least restrictive means of furthering that compelling government interest, then the government can go ahead and enforce that law or policy and force compliance with that law or policy, even though it imposes a burden, a substantial burden, on a person's free exercise or religious-based practice. So what RFRA does, again, is reinstall this much higher constitutional standard than we had, the standard that we had in the Constitution before 1990. And as I think most of us listening are aware, these protections for religious liberty have largely been captured by the religious right wing. In cases like Hobby Lobby, where you have an employer who a religiously conservative employer who does not want to include contraceptive coverage in their employee health plan, even though it's mandated by the Affordable Care Act regulations, it's in those cases and other similar ones where RFRA has been used successfully and very aggressively to avoid compliance with reproductive rights that are otherwise assured under the Constitution, and also for people who can articulate a faith-based justification for not respecting marriage rights for same-sex couples, equality rights for trans and queer people, et cetera. So we're seeing largely, although not exclusively, RFRA being used by the right wing today. And I will note that the Law, Rights, and Religion Project at Columbia, the project that I am the faculty director for, we issued a comprehensive, huge report just a couple of months ago called Whose Faith Matters. And in that report, we recounted all of the contexts where progressive social movements have used religious liberty rights, including sanctuary and immigrants' rights activists today and in the 1980s, but many, many more. Just to draw into question this assumption that RFRA rights, religious liberty rights, are only something that conservative people of faith possess. Of course they aren't. Any person of faith can articulate or assert religious liberty rights under RFRA. So last thing I want to say about this is there are several very well-funded, very well-staffed, very active conservative religious liberty legal nonprofits that have been pushing a lot of these cases, such as the Hobby Lobby case, such as the Amy Stevens case, which is before the Supreme Court today, right now, where a trans woman was fired from her job at a funeral home, and the employer is seeking a religious exemption from having to comply with non-discrimination protections. So, religious liberty question didn't get taken up by the Supreme Court, but thankfully in that case, but it was certainly litigated below. These religious nonprofits, these religious legal nonprofits, the Beckett Fund, Liberty Council, and the Alliance Defending Freedom have been asking the court over and over again in the last several years to revisit Employment Division versus Smith. And once they got Brett Kavanaugh on the court, they were fairly confident that they now had a much higher chance of having the Supreme Court review Employment Division versus Smith, revisit it, and perhaps raise the constitutional protections for religious liberty that existed prior to Employment Division versus Smith. And so the court has now taken that case in Fulton versus City of Philadelphia. They granted certiorari in February. Because the court is sort of on hold right now in terms of arguments, briefing has been put off, and the arguments will take place next fall, most likely. They haven't yet been scheduled, but the briefing takes the merit briefs into August and into September at this point. And in Fulton versus City of Philadelphia, the court explicitly took the question of whether it should revisit Employment Division versus Smith and raise the constitutional standards for protecting religious liberty claims. Just as a little background, Fulton versus City of Philadelphia comes out of the Third Circuit. And the question there is whether the City of Philadelphia violated the free exercise, the constitutional religious liberty rights of the Catholic Social Services provides contracts with the city to provide foster care and adoption services when Catholic Social Services does not want to abide by the local non-discrimination ordinance. They don't want to place kids from foster care, let's say, with same-sex couples or without gay or lesbian adults. And so the court here, unfortunately, I think, is going to be answering the question about what the constitutional standard ought to be. And the fear is that the court will adopt this kind of religious liberty on steroids level of protection that we've seen evolving through the circuits and even the Supreme Court under RFRA. So it's this very strange thing where the Supreme Court had a constitutional standard. The standard was lowered in Smith. Then on a statutory level, the standard was really heightened with RFRA. And then through court interpretations of RFRA, higher even above what the Constitution had protected before, such that, as the advocates working in this area on the right will claim, religious liberty rights can supersede any other fundamental right, whether it's to equality or liberty, et cetera. And the fear now is that those souped up RFRA religious liberty rights will be read back into the Constitution from a statute in a way that will create much higher protections for religious liberty. So that's where we are now. It's a complicated back and forth between Congress and I want to make sure we're back to me. Have I stopped sharing?
Still on the screen.
No. All right, now I'm going to, there we go. Hopefully I've stopped sharing.
No.
Great. This is fun working with this software. So Greg, it's going to be back to you to be the presenter next. So let me just do this very quickly, because I know you have a PowerPoint as well. Ellen, do you want to add anything in terms of how the religious liberty claims from the 1980s, what they look like relative to where the religious liberty law has gone since then?
The only thing I would add is, you know, immigration laws are considered higher than most other criminal laws. And even under this current expectation that the court is going to revert and create a constitutional standard similar to RFRA, they still would say you can't engage in the kind of sanctuary action based upon one's religion or faith. Because when it comes to criminal law, the government is going to look at that as a much higher compelling government interest than most other kinds of actions. So I don't know if that's helpful or not, but.
Well, I think there was a sense of urgency in the 1980s, just as there is today, about the importance of, you know, maintaining the southern border and in, if not just aggressively enforcing our immigration laws, but actually ignoring them and, denying people rights, migrants' rights that they would otherwise have protected under domestic and international law. But one difference I think today from the 80s is today this government also feels that protecting religious liberty rights are of a high order. So you have immigrants' rights and religious liberty rights all coming together in these cases, which I think is a good segue to Greg and what is going on in the current prosecutions. But I want to make a quick announcement before I invite Greg in, is that for attendance verification purposes, please note this code and put it into your attendance affirmation form. The code is D as in dog, E as in establishment, the number 5, E as in establishment, R as in religious, 7, the number 7. So D as in dog, E as in establishment, 5, E establishment, R religion, 7. Okay, great. Take it away. Talk to us a little bit about what's going on with the prosecutions of Scott Warren, how what sorts of defenses you've mustered, how aggressive the federal government has been in these prosecutions, all of it.
All right, I'll get started. First, I wanted to thank you very much for letting me talk. I love an open mic probably more than anything else, and I've missed the opportunity to talk in court with 100 people watching. We had a great deal of community support, more than anything I'd ever seen before, where there'd be 100 or so people coming to court all the time, even for some of the more boring hearings. So I'm going to try to talk for a minute and then put up a PowerPoint and talk a little bit. But just to give you some basic context, this case started for me, as well as for my associate, Amy Knight, that worked on the case with me, on January 17, 2018. And that's when Scott Warren was arrested and charged with 3 felonies for, and I'm going to use some of the terminology the government uses, for harboring illegal aliens and for conspiracy. The charges altogether held about 20 years of prison that he was facing if he were to be convicted and sentenced the most severely possible on all of those charges. We also undertook at that time representing him on 2 misdemeanor charges. The charges in those cases derived from him having allegedly driven on a restricted road in order to put water and supplies out for migrants. That road is on a federal preserve that's called the Cabeza Prieta Wildlife, or National Wildlife Refuge, and it's like 4 million acres or so. It's a huge amount of property, and 90-something percent of it is off limits unless you're walking by foot to access it, and the rest of it is accessible on these administrative roads. So they chose to charge Scott with a misdemeanor for using that road, as well as charging him with misdemeanors for technically they call it abandonment of property, but it's like littering, for putting out jugs of water for migrants. So that's the basic thing that we had going, is we had a 2-charge misdemeanor complaint, as well as a 3-charge felony complaint, and that's what got us going. So at this point, I'm gonna take my face off the screen and put this, I think I'll be able to, did I put my PowerPoint up?
Yeah.
Oh, it is up? Can you tell me, Ellen? I don't see it.
Yes, now it's up.
Okay, good.
Up, not your PowerPoint.
Pardon me?
I think we see your desktop, not your PowerPoint.
Okay. Rats. Let me.
Thank you. So now you have a picture of Scott. Yes. Now we see your PowerPoint. I can't see.
Yeah. All right, start.
Go to the first one. It says United States versus Scott Warren. Got you. Got it. Good.
Okay. So before I get too far into this, my email is there below, and if anybody's got questions for me, I'm happy to talk them over with you later on. So feel free to give me a call. There were a ton of people that supported us in this. It wasn't just my firm. Enormous amounts of help from a lot of people. One of the primary things I want to make sure I thank for is we received the incredibly generous support of a big firm called Perkins Coie. They allowed their full-time jury consultant, Karen Lisko, to work on the case with us, who put together a mock trial with 20 mock jurors and also helped us with our jury questionnaire for the second felony trial. If I didn't mention it, I should have. The first felony trial was tried to a hung jury, 8-4 for acquittal. And then about 6 months later, we did the second felony trial again. And that's when we won the acquittal. And ultimately, Scott was acquitted of all of these charges, both misdemeanor and felony. There's a picture of Scott, and as I don't know how many of you all are criminal law practitioners, but just in my experience, he is one good looking client for having a criminal defense practice. Most of my clients are not nearly as put together, nor can they compellingly testify. Scott testified multiple times. He testified twice in his felony trials. He testified in his misdemeanor trial. He testified at suppression hearings, testified at RFRA hearings. And unlike any other client I've ever had, I was actually glad to have him testifying. He was incredibly articulate. He's got a PhD in I always get it mixed up. I want to call him a geologist, but he's a geographer. He's a cultural geographer from, and he could just talk till the cows come home about the migration, which is what he did his thesis on. He moved down to Ajo, Arizona, and he did his thesis on migration. And his ultimate conclusion was migrants migrate. And they have for thousands of years, and we kind of got to get used to it. So he was absolutely the wrong guy to pick on in this politically motivated prosecution. He was the wrong guy for a whole lot of reasons. But let me provide a little bit more context to this. Basically, we're in Arizona, down here, the red state. That's the part of what we're talking about. But this whole border of Mexico has really been weaponized by the United States. Back in the Clinton era, they developed a program known as Prevention Through Deterrence. And this is also about when No More Deaths began, with the help of their founders, Margo Cow and John Fife and Bill Walker, putting together No More Deaths in order to come up with a non-governmental organization to try to defeat some of these mounting deaths that were occurring. So the area that we're talking about very specifically is not only along the U.S. border, but to the west of Tucson and to the east of Yuma. And it's this enormous area. And if you look up there where it says Gila River, that corresponds more or less with Interstate 8. So the people that cross, the people that have effectively been driven through this prevention through deterrence program to not cross where there are cities and towns and things, but they've been funneled over to cross at this area. And it's basically 40 miles, more or less, between the Mexican border and Interstate 8. And through all of the land that they need to cross, it's all federal land and the Tohono O'odham land. And there's very little out there in terms of anything to save your life, like water or a farmhouse or a town. It's just all federal land. And much of it is completely inaccessible. The military range is an active bombing range up there at the top. So if the migrants are successful enough to get far enough north through the Cabeza Prieta, they're onto an active bombing range where their bodies will never be found. So that's the context of where we're at and what was going on in January of 2018 when Scott was arrested. That's an overhead view. Shows you it's very desolate. It's the most extreme environment in North America. This is a map of recovered human remains from 2011 to 2020. And this part of the map is a smaller section of the map that I just showed you. And each one of these red dots is where human remains were found. So you can see that there's a corridor that runs along where those mountains had been, generally speaking. And it's over a 7-year period, and it's just stunningly remarkable the number of people who have perished out there whose remains have been found. That's a tiny percentage of the remains that have been actually found. Some archaeologists estimate that perhaps 10% of the remains perhaps 10 times more people have perished out there than their remains have been discovered because of the way the environment and the animals and the inaccessibility add up to making it very, very difficult for anybody to get out there to find the remains. So this is the background context for what Scott was dealing with when he was arrested and charged with harboring, and also what he was dealing with when he was charged with putting water out into the desert. And if you look up here in the where the top line of red dots is, that's the area that Scott was attempting to access when he was charged with driving on a restricted road. And I should also mention that those roads are restricted, but not for everybody. They're not restricted for Border Patrol. And most significantly, from a standpoint of just what a horrible world it is that we're living in, they're not restricted. They're not restricted for game and fish to truck water out there. Game and Fish, the Wildlife Department, trucks water on those restricted roads and puts water out for pronghorn sheep and certain other animals, and then they sell tags to hunters to kill those animals. But they restrict the roads from human beings using them to put water out for human beings. So that's why I was so pissed off that I decided to take Scott's case on and do it for the next couple of years. It was just phenomenal to me that this was occurring. I should also mention that this isn't just some loony left-wing humanitarians talking about these bodies being recovered. This is an annual report, a portion of the annual report from the Pima County Office of the Medical Examiner, that shows the number of bodies that have been recovered. UBC means undocumented border crosser. So these are the number of undocumented border crosser bodies that were recovered over the years from calendar year 2000 through 2017. And then you can see how they're recovered by months. And obviously in the summer months, it gets extraordinarily deadly out there. So Scott was ticketed on the misdemeanor for putting water out, driving on the restricted road in June of 2017, where the temperatures in that time of year are routinely over 120 degrees in the desert. That is what I'm showing you now is a ramshackle old building in what we call the town of Ajo. Ajo is the only town in those 40 miles or so on that map that I showed you, between the border and Interstate 8, which is what the migrants are shooting for. Get to Interstate 8, and then hopefully there'll be a way to catch a ride from there, either going west to California or east towards Phoenix. So this is where Scott was arrested on January 17 of 2018. And his crime, if you will, is he allowed two young migrants from Central America, one from Honduras and one from El Salvador, who stumbled into this area called the barn. Scott, working with No More Deaths, allowed them to stay while they recovered from flu-like symptoms as well as blisters on their feet. And this is the entryway to the barn property. It's a house on 5 acres. And anyway, then this is water, pallets of water that they obtain, and No More Deaths takes them out on trucks way out into the desert and puts them along the paths where they know that the migrants are dying and where the literal trails of death are. That's Scott and me in the background talking on our phones, but not to each other apparently. And then this is a picture from when they executed the search warrant of some of the supplies that were inside the barn, which the government called a way station. We called a humanitarian aid station. And as you can see, it's not sophisticated, but that's what they were doing in there, was collecting up and the medical supplies and then taking them to where they most needed to be. So let me see if I can toggle back for a second. There. So I got a couple more pictures, but I did want to let you know that. So here's the additional background. It was not serendipitous that the government swooped in on Scott on the 17th of January, 2018. That's the morning of that day when No More Deaths, one arm of No More Deaths is, I don't want to call it a publicity arm, but there's the working folks, the working groups, Desert Aid working groups arm, and then there's more of a political arm, an activist arm, and that more activist arm of No More Deaths issued a very well publicized report, abuse documentation report that morning, and held a press conference and forwarded the abuse report to the Border Patrol. And within the abuse report, it explained through a scientific analysis that over a course of 3 years, Border Patrol agents had intentionally destroyed more than 3,000 1-gallon water bottles of water that No More Deaths volunteers had left out in the desert for dying migrants. And included in the abuse documentation report was some video, which has been widely distributed. In fact, I think we determined that at some point there were more than 27 million views of this video, but it's video from like wildlife cameras, motion sensor cameras that were set up, and they show Border Patrol agents in uniform slashing the bottles, kicking them over, pouring them out with apparent glee. So that's what happened the morning of the Border Patrol's decision to set up surveillance at the barn. They knew about the barn quite extensively. They'd been doing I don't even want to call it an investigation, it was so slipshod, but they had been doing an investigation of a certain sort of Scott, because Scott had written some articles for Northern Arizona University, as well as some other publications. And Scott routinely led high school students, as well as some college students, on what they call water drops, and gave them an education of what was going on the border, and talked with them about the 3,000 bodies that have been found along the border and the much more probable, astronomically high estimates of the number of people that had died on the border. So they were very well aware of Scott. Scott lived in Ajo, small town. I forget if it's 3,000 or 6,000 people, but it's a very small town, and he lived there, and they knew him, and they knew what car he was driving. So they spotted him out on the barn property the afternoon of the 17th, and then, oddly enough, began texting, and we got their texts with glee about it was Scott. And it was not only Scott, who's about 10 feet tall and white and long hair. I mean, he's a very distinctive guy. But it's not only Scott, who's very clearly a gringo, but they were across the way. They were hidden a few hundred yards away with a spotting scope. And they saw Scott with two brown people. And then they really got excited. So they immediately determined that the brown people must be migrants, or in their terminology, they must be Tonks. And they began texting to one another that there were Tonks at the barn. And if you're, let me just go back to the screenshot here, see if I can show you my, is that showing the screen, Ellen?
Yes.
Okay. So I asked the Border Patrol agent what Tonks meant. And I specifically asked, is that the sound that a metal flashlight makes when it hits the head of an immigrant? And he acknowledged that he'd heard that among other definitions. But ultimately, he took the position that when he said that there were Tonks at the barn, he meant temporarily out of native country, which I later mentioned really would have been a Tunk, not a Tonk, but didn't seem to particularly matter to him. So we had that going on in terms of some pretty severe Fourth Amendment violations, but they ultimately decided to do what's known in legal parlance as a knock and talk. And it's a method where they can come onto a person's property and knock on the door. And then if you're foolish enough to answer and come out and answer their questions, then they develop probable cause over the course of their conversation with you. So they did that, which was a bunch, it was just a dog and pony show. But ultimately the judge did not suppress the evidence, even though it was wildly illegal. We filed motions to dismiss for selective enforcement because it was clear that they were focused on Scott for advocating on behalf of migrants in the first place. We filed to move we move to dismiss for violation of RFRA, as well as for international law violations. And as I'm accustomed to doing, we just kept losing. But we filed a whole lot of motions. And I should mention that I do capital defense. And so that's why I say I'm accustomed to losing. I often win something, but I typically lose almost everything in the run-up to ultimately winning.
Greg, we've got about 10 more minutes in this segment just to give you a time check.
Okay, thank you. So sure. We did ultimately have some fun and games with the government. This reminded me of something Ellen was mentioning a few minutes ago, just before our last felony trial. We were in the back with the judge and chambers going over jury questionnaires, and I at some moment said something about how my opening statement the next day was going to be all about Trump putting people in cages, putting children in cages. And of course that wasn't the opening statement, but they took it seriously and moved to prevent the defense from mentioning the president or his policies or anything else about him. And actually the judge granted that motion, but it didn't matter, because what we were really looking for ultimately in our felony case was to, we knew we couldn't get we couldn't get a jury of his peers. We weren't gonna impanel 12 people that were right thinking. So what we shot for was impaneling the majority right thinking, and then tailoring our argument to them, not so much on RFRA or on necessity or anything else, but just a lack of evidence, that Scott had actually done anything wrong. And we were able to get the judge to give this jury instruction. And we took the position that what Scott did was he allowed, as any good Samaritan would, he allowed these migrants to be at the barn and have water and food and medical care over a course of days. And he didn't have any obligation to report. And ultimately the jury did conclude, the second felony jury did conclude, that there just simply was no evidence. Insufficient evidence that he was guilty. So I mentioned before that we got a whole bunch of support from the media and from No More Deaths and the people that turned out. And one of the places that you can take a look if you feel like looking at this more is the Intercept.com sent out a courtroom artist who clearly had some biases towards the defense and against the prosecution. That's the defense on the left and the prosecution on the right. But they, Ryan Devereaux is a reporter that did a series on the run-up to the trials as well as the trials. And ultimately we got an acquittal and had a celebration out at the, on the courthouse steps. That's how it ended. In terms of how RFRA played out, the judge ultimately ruled that RFRA protected Scott's actions in putting in littering, and he was allowed to abandon property on the Federal Reserve, and that was protected by Scott's religious freedom under RFRA. But the judge convicted him of using the administrative roads to access the trail of death where he was putting the water out. Then the day that he was to be sentenced on that charge, on that conviction, the government dismissed the charges and refused my invitation to explain what their good faith basis was for dismissing the charges as compared to their presumptively bad faith basis for pursuing the charges for 2 years. So that's how RFRA ultimately played out. We withdrew the RFRA instruction in the felony trial, in the first felony trial, after Scott had testified, largely because it was apparent that the government was going to be able to put on evidence relative to its compelling interest. And we knew from the jury questions during the course of the trial that we had some bad actors on that jury. And we didn't want them to glom on to the government's compelling interest or allegedly compelling interest in controlling the borders. For instance, after the medical examiner testified about the 3,000 bodies and about all the extra staff that he actually had to hire to do the autopsies and the forensic evaluation on the undocumented border crossers, one of the jurors held up a question and we took it at sidebar. And the question was, who's paying for this extra expense evaluating and doing these autopsies on these illegals? So given our jury pool, we had to be pretty careful about what doors we opened with the RFRA defense. The misdemeanor, great, by the way, was just a bench trial, and the felony was a jury trial. So,
but can I ask you a question about the hung jury in the first trial?
Yeah.
So you did put in some evidence of Scott's faith-based beliefs, even though you withdrew the motion later, is that right?
That's right. We had Scott testify for quite a while. I can't remember how many hours, but Scott probably testified for about 4.5 hours. And on the first day, he testified about his beliefs relative to what he sees now when he sees migrants, live migrants, stumbling in and out of the desert. And it had to do with finding a number of bodies and body parts while he's been out in the desert, and a particular, I don't want to demean it by calling it this, but a particular spiritual experience that he has when he discovers body parts in the desert, and the fact that these people not only died a horrific death, but they almost certainly died it alone. Because what happens in these migrant crossings is they cross in groups, and then one person gets slowed down for some reason. It's either exhaustion or exposure or diarrhea or blisters or whatever, but something happens and one person slows down and the rest can't afford to slow down because they literally cannot carry enough water to get all the way across. So it's a question of when they're going to rescue, whether they're going to rescue. So what happens is the people that die almost always die alone. They've had to be abandoned. And Scott knew that, and that resonated with him in a way that he was able to articulate that for the misdemeanor, in particular, the judge found that was a religious belief, a sincere belief of conscience. So we put that evidence on for the jury in the felony trial. And then once it became apparent that they were going to be calling in a bunch of yeehaws from Washington to testify about the masses on the border and the horde, et cetera, we decided to withdraw that defense.
But at that point, you'd already put that evidence in, and I'm wondering if you have a feeling of whether Scott testifying to what you've just described to us, which is just, you know, it's just hearing it, and I've heard it before, it's still so devastating. To what degree do you think that influenced the jury that they would end up not being able to convict, but as a hung jury, just to get that evidence in, even if there's no formal finding on the RFRA motion?
Yeah, I think it was important for them to hear from Scott, and And also, it didn't have just to do with a RFRA defense. It had to do with why he did what he was doing. And we took the position that he's always able to explain his motivations. We didn't elaborate about the spiritual component nearly as much as we would have if we had continued with the RFRA defense. I think it had a big impact. One thing I should mention is these prosecutors decided quite foolishly to try to impeach Scott with an opinion piece that he'd authored the day before trial that the Washington Post picked up. And the piece had to do with the various negative impacts that prosecuting members of families of undocumented people could have, and it elaborated on not only Scott's beliefs and the bodies that he'd found, but a bunch of other stuff that was completely irrelevant and inadmissible in the trial. But the prosecutor abused it when he was trying to impeach really inarticulately with it. So the judge allowed us on redirect and under Rule 106 to have Scott read the op-ed to the jury, which is something I'll probably never have happen again. But it was a nice development.
Katherine, can I ask a question?
Yeah, please jump in.
Sure. So what's interesting about this is RFRA sounded like it was a jury question, and I'm wondering whether you had to litigate that, because certainly, you know, if you compare that to what happened in the 80s, the court would never have allowed the religion claim to go to the jury. They would have decided as a matter of law whether or not the compelling state interest was sufficient or not.
Yeah, well, we asked the judge to decide that pretrial. We had a pretrial hearing about it, and ultimately the judge, I can't remember exactly how it worked out, but ultimately the government took the position that there were some actions that Scott took, primarily relative to the conspiracy charge, that would not be covered by RFRA. And consequently, because there was a dispute about what actions would be covered by RFRA and what actions would not, the judge said it's premature to decide this in advance of trial. And consequently, he had us draft up proposed jury instructions. So it kind of turned around to bite him in the butt in a certain respect. But I think RFRA is clear and the case law is clear. There's a Ninth Circuit case called Christie where something similar to this happened. And it was pretty straightforwardly clear that these are issues that need to be decided before a jury trial takes place. The protections promised by RFRA are, in order for them to really be fully enjoyed by the religious practitioner, include not being prosecuted, not just getting the opportunity to make your case to a jury. They shouldn't be prosecuted at all.
I will note to the folks who are listening in that the materials that we distributed in advance and that are also available as handouts in the GoToWebinar software include an amicus brief that I wrote on behalf of law professors who are experts in religious liberty. And what we've been doing in cases like Scott's, but in several across the country, is in many of these cases submitting the briefs with an architecture for the judge to use in deciding all of the different elements of the RFRA case. So you've got the question of whether the beliefs that the person is describing are religious or moral in nature, or political in nature for that matter. But it is the burden of the movement who's raising the RFRA claim to show that their beliefs were religious in nature, that they were sincerely held, that they were burdened and substantially burdened by the government's actions. And then if you can prevail in those elements, the burden shifts to the government to show they have a compelling interest and that they're accomplishing or furthering that compelling interest through the least restrictive means. Some of these elements are mixed questions of law and fact. Some of them are subjective and some are objective questions. I mean, it feels like an evidence final exam kind of moment in the webinar here. And we walk through in the brief all of those questions. And part of what our strategy has been as we kind of move into the ethics part of our discussion now, in writing these briefs, it's not necessarily to come in on the side of either the person making the RFRA motion or on the side of the government, for sure, but to come in on neither side in order to have these cases be an opportunity to not just clarify, but improve the law of religious liberty in ways where we've really seen setbacks where the right wing is raising religious liberty claims, like in Hobby Lobby and some of the other cases that have followed, where the courts are willing to just defer to the person who says, hey, I have a faith-based, sincerely held religious belief here, and it's substantially burdened. The question of substantial burden should be a question of law for the court, an objective test for the court, not me, the faith-based person, saying, oh, I felt substantially burdened, which is basically what happened in Hobby Lobby. And so part of what I really appreciate about the case, about the way the RFRA claim proceeded in Scott's case and some of the other cases where we've done amicus briefs, is we're getting the courts to elaborate in greater detail on how those elements should work as questions of fact or law, as questions of that are object or subjective in nature, who carries the burden and what that burden looks like. Because if you look at Hobby Lobby and the Supreme Court's Justice Alito's decision there, the plaintiff's case is merely a matter of pleading. Right? They don't ask very much of the Green family, of the owners of Hobby Lobby, in terms of the sincerity of their beliefs or the questions about substantiality of burden. So, I appreciate that Greg let us intervene as amicus in this case, and as I said, we've done it in several others, and we're just starting to get opinions from courts that clarify these issues. Ellen, other questions for Greg?
It's a really important brief, Catherine, and I think the point that I was asking Greg about is this extent to which the jury gets to decide some of these questions, because you don't want the court to be deciding criminal cases whether or not the defense exists or not, unless it's absolutely a matter of law, but the extent to which there are factual questions, the ability to send those questions to the jury allows a jury to acquit in the difficult cases.
That's precisely right, whether it's the jury or the finder of fact, which sometimes is the judge, but where you have a jury trial, some of these RFRA questions cannot be resolved on the papers. They actually have to go to a jury. Was that your position, Greg?
Not really. And it's probably because I practice in Arizona. And federal juries in particular in Arizona are not especially friendly. But the other thing is Scott's sincerely held beliefs were certainly sincerely held, but they were not anything approaching what would normally be, in lay terms, perceived as religious. His father at one point testified pre-trial, and or maybe it was during the trial of the misdemeanor, I've forgotten. But at one point his father said, in response to the prosecution's cross-examination of him, what kind of church he took his son to when he was growing up. He said he went to the Church of the Great Outdoors. And you know, Scott, truthfully, as well as his father, are very spiritual people. But you can't say, oh yeah, he's a Presbyterian or he's a Jewish person or he's a this. They're fully non-denominational in terms of their religious spiritual beliefs.
The religious liberty law is quite clear on this issue, is that you don't have to have a traditional religion that has a structure that you go to on Saturday or Sunday at all.
I agree with that. And that wasn't really even in the question But my fear was, while a judge is going to be able to follow that instruction pretty well, the kind of jurors that are asking who's paying for the autopsies are going to glom onto that and say that's a fake religious belief. You know, if that's one of the check marks I have to go down on my on an interrogatory to determine whether he fits the bill for RFRA, that's one I can fight on. If I have that level of hatred for people from the other side of the border.
I'm surprised, Greg, that after you withdrew your RFRA claim, that the government did not move to preclude consideration of Scott's rendition of his religious, sincerely held religious beliefs.
They did.
It would have happened in our case for sure, but so we have a judge, I know.
I knew your judge, and he's quite a different judge than the judge we had. Our judge is Rainer Collins, who unfortunately recently went on senior status. And he has done a number of these cases, not to the extent that we did this case, but he's done pretrial rulings on these no more deaths cases. And it's pretty clear historically that he's not a big fan of prosecuting people for helping for helping migrants survive. Whereas I think Earl Carroll might have been a fan of that. Judge Collins gave us...
What was our judge? Sorry, I don't think it was clear. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. Judge Collins, you know, I disagree with him on many things, but he gave us a much fairer shake than a lot of judges would have. And that was one of the issues that government brought up, is they moved to strike all of Scott's testimony relative to his religious beliefs. And I took the position that his testimony wasn't about his religious beliefs, it was about his motivations for his actions, and that was relevant, and that I wouldn't ask him about a particular ceremony that he performed whenever he found a body. Okay. The jury asked him about that. I mean, that's one, I don't know if you do that everywhere, but in Arizona, the judges really encourage a lot of jury questionnaires. So after direct and cross and redirect, we would have 15 or 20 questions that the jurors would write down, the bailiff would pick up and bring over, and we'd discuss them at sidebar. So they were it's always like reading tea leaves when you're trying to figure out where the jury is leaning. But it was pretty clear that at the beginning of our first trial, all of them were against Scott. And then by virtue of the questions, it became clearer that some of them were for Scott, and then a lot of them were for Scott, but we still had this group. We couldn't, the judge on the first trial wouldn't automatically exclude Border Patrol agents from our voir dire, from our panel. I mean, we had to burn peremptories on agents. So unfortunately, we got a jury questionnaire on that basis. I mean, I took the position, this is all your fault, judge. You didn't do an adequate voir dire like we asked you to. You didn't do a jury questionnaire like we asked you to, and we're going to waste another several weeks in trial on the second trial unless you give a lengthy questionnaire. So he allowed us to do a lengthy questionnaire, and then he let us do not quite individual voir dire, but voir dire of quite a few of the prospective jurors at the sidebar. So we had a better understanding of our panel for the second jury.
Let me just pop in here for a second and note a couple of things. And one of them is to our listeners, is that if you have questions for any of the panelists, please write them in the question area on the website here. And I'm trying to respond to those that I've been seeing. The second thing is that we should also note that there were two other groups of No More Deaths activists who were prosecuted for misdemeanors as well, roughly around the same time as in Scott's case. And the first ones that progressed where there was a religion, where there was a RFRA claim raised, the magistrate judge that was sitting on the case, presiding in it early on, dismissed the RFRA claim, calling it a modified Antigone defense. Really an insult to RFRA, to religion, and of course to these No More Deaths activists. We wrote a brief appealing from that decision, and thankfully that decision was overturned, but not before their second group decided to take a plea because they were worried about a conviction based on the first group's conviction, which is now under being reviewed on appeal. So Scott's not alone as the only person in No More Deaths who's being who's been monitored by the feds and prosecuted by the feds. And I just want to note that different judges are ruling in different ways on these RFRA claims. But there's one question I want to put out to both of you, which I know is something that the No More Deaths activists struggle with, and I know the people who are doing similar work in New York with New Sanctuary Coalition are thinking about too, which is when we raise these religious liberty claims, to what extent are they really only benefiting people like Scott, who is relatively quite privileged, to be sure, as compared with the people whose aid he's coming to? And is there some way that we can understand these religious liberty claims as benefiting not just the sanctuary activists, but the refugees, the migrants themselves, who, after all, is the welfare that we should be ultimately, I think, caring about the most? And I will, probe at a difficult ethical question, which is, if we go back to how Dr. Martin Luther King used religious liberty as part of his criminal defense tactics when he was arrested over and over and wrote a letter from a Birmingham jail explaining why he was violating the law in the name of his religious beliefs, there he was very clear, I'm not seeking an exemption from criminal prosecution and paying the penalty under the criminal law. We're going to sit this out in jail. So the progressive civil rights strategy then was to pay the penalty in order to prove the depth of the immorality of Jim Crow segregation and the violence of race-based violence in the South at the time, whereas right-wing people today are using RFRA as a way to say, I don't want to pay any penalty. I don't want to go to jail. I don't want to pay a fine. I don't want to have to comply with the law in any way. That's what the Hobby Lobby case was all about. And is there some way that on the left we could have a different strategy than just borrowing the tools of the right and say, hey, we don't have to pay a penalty, we don't have to comply with the law, and instead look backwards to the ways in which Dr. King and other activists in the civil rights movement didn't see themselves as above the law. They used the arrest as a way to prove the moral bankruptcy of the state and the communities in which they lived. Thoughts about that? This is, again, I'm trying to provoke an ethical conversation, because we do need to be talking about those issues as well. Ellen, do you have some thoughts there?
Well, I'm the resident ethicist, and given the fact you need ethics credits, you know, I'll talk about it. I mean, look, I have many thoughts. That is a CLE unto itself. I will just say that, you know, criminal laws are the powers of the state, and I don't think we want to be minimizing the extent to which the federal government can use those powers in negative ways against progressives as well as against the right wing. So I don't want to encourage a restriction of the ability to raise defenses in certain cases. I think, you know, during Martin Luther King's era, there was a different strategy. That is not, that strategy could be appropriate now, but it isn't the only strategy. You have to put law in the context of the social movement of the time. And it seems to me that it's both appropriate to raise a RFRA defense the way that they did in Scott Warren's case, and also at the same time simultaneously talk about the refugees. Certainly you could do that, and I assume if you had the RFRA claim within that case, he would have talked about the refugees, and I assume he did when he talked about the motive. So that's one way in which that arises. The other piece is that when I go back to the 80s, what we didn't only defend in the criminal case, we also filed a civil case at the Center for Constitutional Rights, an equal protection claim on behalf of Salvadoran refugees that actually raised all those issues. And most surprisingly to those of us who litigated it, we won. We won long-term, and it ended up ensuring that a number of Salvadorans were able to actually get asylum. So overall, I think it's a political question of how you use the law, and that's just a start. So Greg, you want to, and I have a lot more to say, but I don't want to monopolize this.
Greg? I want you to say a lot more, because I only had one thing to say, and I just wanted to clarify that the other defendants that you mentioned that had their that were ultimately convicted, there were two sets of four each. Four went to trial, and the magistrate convicted them, and then they appealed successfully to the district court. And Judge Marquez of U.S. District Court here in Tucson wrote an opinion upholding, reversing their convictions and upholding the appropriateness of RFRA as it applied to each of those four defendants. So it's an important decision. And the government was threatening to appeal that to the Ninth Circuit, and they dismissed that about a week after they dismissed the conviction of, I'm sorry, dismissed the charge against Scott Warren, basically in order to make sure that neither case got to the Ninth Circuit, where more, where even stronger precedent for RFRA on behalf of progressives could be made. So I wanted to clarify that aspect of what had happened with the other defendants.
Right.
Because there is some good law out there now, authored by Judge Marquez as well as by Judge Collins.
Yeah. Judge Marquez's reversal of the magistrate judge's Antigone defense position was a wonderful victory. So. Taking 1 second break, for those of you who want CLE credit for today, for attendance verification purposes, please note this course code. Ready? Get your pens out. W as in water, A as in asylum, 7-3, R as in RFRA. So it's W as in water, A is in asylum, 7-3, R as in RFRA or religion. Thank you. I've got a question from the audience here, and I'll send it out to either one of you about elaborating a little bit more on what kind of trial tactics, what kind of methods might you use to keep the government's moral bankruptcy, just the pure cruelty of this government in the trial as much as possible. I thought RFRA was in the Scott's case, in the first trial, provided an opportunity to contrast his moral beliefs with what clearly was the immorality of the government. But how would you both, as seasoned trial attorneys, think about what kind of strategies would you use to make sure that the lives, the dignity, the welfare of the migrants, the asylum seekers that No More Deaths is showing up for somewhere in this trial, and it's not just about sanctuary activists being able to use their privilege in these sorts of proceedings?
Now, I would start with language. I think we both talked about the way in which the government uses language in trials. This is just maybe a minor point, but the notion of calling people aliens was so disturbing that it seems to me every time that the government does that, one should point out to the jury, until, of course, you're going to get held in contempt if you do it too frequently and the judge tells you to stop. But you should really use language that dignifies people. Rather than demeans them. So that's one. I think you have to fight and fight really hard to be able to present evidence of the conditions that lead to the prosecution. Why did the person engage in this kind of conduct? It sounds like if you have a good judge, the way that Greg did, you'll be able to get some leeway and be able to do that. Other judges, like the kind of judge we had, is certainly not going to allow that to happen. But you always have to be on guard, I think, for the ways in which the government is going to try to skew this, you know, in almost in imperceptible ways to the jury. So that just starts, Greg.
The only thing I was going to say is I always prefer to cross-examine, just because I'm a control freak and I have a little bit more control that way. And in our case, during the government's rebuttal, they brought in, I can't remember what his name was or what his position was, but he was supposedly a ringer from Washington, D.C., who was a high official with Border Patrol, something called Boar Star. And Boar Star is this search and rescue operation for Border Patrol. And they've got the big helicopters and everything. And they take the position that they're the real first responders and that they're there as a humanitarian aid organization to protect and find lost migrants, et cetera. Well, and this was the head guy. And on cross-examination, he was unfamiliar with the phrase prevention through deterrence. He didn't even know about that policy. He didn't know how many bodies had been found in the Tucson sector. He didn't know anything about the things that matter most to anybody that's got a scintilla of humanity. And we were able to bring those things out via cross-examination, which all had to do with, basic credibility of the witness. So it would be, I think it would be difficult for a judge, even an unfair-minded one, to preclude examination of those kind of issues. So I think to get the truth out to jurors and journalists watching these trials, sometimes the easiest way is through the government's own witnesses.
Yeah.
The rules of evidence.
Sorry, these trials are not in a vacuum. I mean, in both of our cases, there is a great deal of public support. So one of the ethical questions, Katherine, is, of course, you're the lawyer for the individual, but the individual is part of a movement, and there are movement people who will be in the courtroom who want to engage in certain kind of conduct. And to what extent do you talk to them about the tactics that they might use in the audience? And to what, because it might undermine your case. But you need to be cognizant of tools other than the traditional lawyer tools in the courtroom. I mean, I know one of the instances in our case is the beginning of the trial, a man stood up and threw blood all over the courtroom. That's the way our trial started. Per person in the audience, he was removed from the court. We didn't know about that. We didn't have anything to do with it. But I imagine that people in the sanctuary movement did, and one has to think about what are the implications for your client. The other thing is if you talking to the press, that's yet another piece of a strategy. We were under a gag order. I actually was almost held in contempt because I forgot Oral Carroll's order at some point. I just didn't pay attention to it, and I was commenting to the press on the courthouse steps. But the media is yet another way to be able to talk about what's the trial really about. And the trial's really about trying to help migrants and protect them. So the strategy is an overall one in a political context.
Well, that leads me to a question we have that's come in from one of our viewers, who's my wonderful colleague, my brilliant colleague, Kendall Thomas. He's asking, aside from the different historical moments, whether it's King and working in the civil rights movement or the sanctuary activists in the 80s or today, isn't another difference between Dr. King's approach to faith-based activism and Warren's? Is that Scott Warren doesn't see himself as engaging in a politics of civil disobedience or in as maybe a larger politics at all. So I guess I would ask Greg, is that true? How do you think Scott and the other activists see themselves and the work that they're doing in the desert is related to a larger movement, migrants' rights movement, sanctuary rights movement, et cetera?
I think Scott was really surprised at being perceived as an activist. I mean, he's not an activist. He's been foisted into a position of everybody knowing him and knowing about his activities, and he's routinely called an activist in the press. But Scott testified very well that the reason he ultimately got involved in this is because you live longer in the desert if you have water. But he was really troubled for a long time. It was Hamlet-like, frankly, whether he should be doing anything that might ultimately encourage people, give them hope that they'll make it if they cross the desert, or whether he should be doing something else. And he finally came down on the side of understanding that, or concluding that migrants are going to migrate. Situations that they're escaping are incomprehensible to lucky people like us. And they're, to the extent that they're doing any sort of a risk-benefit analysis, it's uninformed, and it has got more benefit than we can understand. So he does what he does in order to save lives.
Yeah.
And he doesn't do it in order to poke a stick in the government's eye. I mean, frankly, I don't consider myself an activist either, but I did what I did because I was just so outraged and helpless feeling about the Trump administration. They'd been in power for almost exactly a year when they decided to go after Scott. And I felt like I needed to do something activism-wise, and it gave me a great relief and a wonderful outlet to be able to represent him. But that's not how Scott saw it. Scott did what he did because he's a true humanitarian.
Right. Well, it's interesting. We have these competing frames, and Kendall Thomas notes this in the questions box as well to us, is that the humanitarian aid frame tends to depoliticize and in a way almost decontextualize both the precarity of certain human lives and then the actions of those who come to the aid of those people who are in such desperate circumstances, we would oppose that perhaps to sanctuary. A sanctuary movement would see itself as part of a larger politics that keeps questions of government power and government evil really in the picture. And I guess the harder question for us is, where does RFRA figure? Where do religious rights, liberty rights, are they depoliticizing, or are they an opportunity to politicize? And at what point is that a good criminal defense tactic? And at what point is it perhaps counterproductive given the interest of the individual client? I have another question I'd love to pose to Ellen from Thomas Scott Railton, who is has been a wonderful thought partner for us on the scope of RFRA, has written a excellent article, note in the Yale Law Journal on religious liberty rights. And he's asking whether you could say, Ellen, what your thinking is about whether RFRA would have been a successful tool to use in the cases that you had in the 80s, had you had a RFRA like we do today.
And I think I said a version of this before. The extent to which any question could have gone to the jury on that balance between the religious beliefs versus compelling interest, least restrictive alternative, et cetera, we might have had a chance with the jury to convince some of them that they should vote to acquit. But I would suspect that if before Earl Carroll then, if we had that, he would decide as a matter of RFRA, as a matter of law, would not go be a question that would go to the jury, because he would have decided, despite your sincerely held religious belief, there was the compelling government interest in the enforcement of the immigration law. And so that's why I say I'm encouraged by what's going on now, the ways in which if it goes to a jury, you have some chance at least of convincing the jury that the person should acquit. Or should be acquitted, I should say.
Okay, and so there are more questions under RFRA that seem ripe for going to the jury than under the old First Amendment standard. as it was in existence during during the 80s when you were litigating these issues.
Correct. I mean, I would also say, you know, it's once again, Katherine, be careful what you wish for, because you know, you could have right-wing people engaging in religious actions, they get prosecuted, and then the jury in that jurisdiction decides, okay, we get to decide these questions, we're going to acquit them, right?
Right, right. Greg, did you have any hesitation in using a tool that had been really the well-worn tool of the right wing in a case like this?
I didn't have any hesitation in it. That's probably because I've never been invited to speak at an ethics seminar before, but I saw it as a tool to help us win. And I feel my ultimate obligation is to be a zealous defender. And I mean, frankly, we should have won on every one of these motions we filed. I mean, it was a horrible violation of his Fourth Amendment rights. There were violations of the selective enforcement was obvious. I mean, you have to. So I felt like we would win on a bunch of things, and RFRA was one that we threw in. That I once I read about it, actually once Thomas alerted me to the existence of RFRA, and I considered it to be a sharp tool in our box, but it wasn't something that we were relying completely on. The only other thing, and I don't know how to say this particularly well because I'm not anything close to a scholar, but I remember that there's a portion of the compelling governmental need analysis that can be undercut by demonstrating that there's an exception, that the government has made exceptions to its supposedly compelling governmental need to prosecute. And I know that was a big deal in Hobby Lobby. And it was also, I considered it to be, should have been a big deal in our misdemeanor case, the fact that the government made all kind of exceptions in its supposed need to restrict access to those administrative roads. They made all kind of exceptions for water delivery so that you could later go kill animals, as well as for archaeologists and for Border Patrol. Border Patrol just runs roughshod over all of these protected species out there in their quads and jeeps and stuff. So and frankly, the wall itself being constructed is a major environmental exception to the supposed rules that they have to be protecting the environment out there. So that seems to be something that could be used as something to be putting in front of juries as well if you're going to be using RFRA in a jury context.
And yeah, I know when you and I talked about whether you might make that argument around exceptions, my heart stopped, because you know that is one of the lead arguments now being made by those who don't want to comply with the Affordable Care Act, is that the law was, you know, carefully and in a very complex, the Affordable Care Act was crafted to satisfy a whole range of complex interests and contexts, and so the exceptions that were included or the complexity of the ACA, it's really troubling to see that then being used as a reason why those who have faith-based reasons for non-compliance should be granted exemptions. And we're seeing that argument being used in a number of cases, so I was kind of thrilled to see that you didn't use that here.
Well,
I have to be really careful, because most criminal defense lawyers, given the fact that it's the power of the state against your individual client, are going to feel comfortable using most arguments in order to ensure that the client not get convicted. I would caution us in thinking about building a social justice movement on the backs of criminal defendants. People accused of crime should not be responsible necessarily for having to build a social movement through that case. Right, you can use that in civil cases and say we should think twice about raising claims and how we raise them. But I think we have to be a lot more cautious about putting that burden upon someone accused of crime.
I think that is so important. And we've talked a lot at the Law, Rights, and Religion Project, but also with our movement partners about the difference between using it on defense or offense, using RFRA on defense or offense. And it is a lot to ask of a criminal defendant. It's so true. Last thoughts, both of you?
I was only going to say that I think the ethical obligations of a criminal defense lawyer to zealously defend his or her client don't comport especially well with the ethical obligations of the progressive movement on whether to be using RFRA or not. I mean, a good example would be like the Stand Your Ground law. A criminal defense lawyer needs to use that if his client was allegedly standing his ground when he killed the guy. It's incumbent on the lawyer to raise every viable defense. So I don't think it's a particularly good mix. I mean, the whole RFRA is social engineering with a chainsaw instead of a scalpel from my perspective. But as a criminal defense lawyer, I got an obligation to do what's best for the client and most likely to get his acquittal.
Well, isn't your obligation to advise your client of their options? And given the political nature of so many of the No More Deaths activists and their, you know, their deep commitment to this work, it's really up to them to decide which of these defenses they're comfortable using. And they may not want to use every tool in the toolkit because of the larger social justice movement and the interests of the communities that they're trying to work with.
Thank you for making that point. I think the other piece is that progressive criminal defense lawyers don't necessarily have to take every single case, right? And so if they don't think the case is righteous, like the Stand Your Ground case, if you're a public defender, you may have to do it. But if you're a private lawyer, that's not the kind of case you want to undertake necessarily.
Well, this is a great place for us to end on this quandary of the politics of criminal defense work and how it's interacted with these really important cases. I want to thank both of you for joining us today. I want to thank our many people who've been watching and for your thoughtful questions. And we'll see you again online soon.
Thank you so much, Katherine. This has been terrific. And I hope the people on the webinar have enjoyed it as well.
Me too.
I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you both.